first trip up from Statesboro, Georgia for the Georgia Southern Eagles as they visit Chapel Hill, North Carolina in a beautiful day for college football in week six of the NCAA season. Here from Keenan Stadium in Chapel Hill, Ryan Rose and Jeremy Bloom with you. Hey, look, it's Jeremy Bloom. We got him in the booth. We're here talking Georgia Southern and North Carolina football. And Jeremy, gosh, we had a lot of questions coming into this season about who's going to be where, and even on the offensive line into week six, we don't know who's going to be where. A lot of banged up guys for North Carolina up front.
A lot of banged up guys. They lost eight offensive linemen since the start of training camp. Kyle Jolly has more starts than anyone on the offensive line, and they're going to have their work cut out with him. John Shoup, the offensive coordinator, said they're going against two outstanding defensive linemen for Georgia Southern, number 90, Markeith Wiley, and number 66, Brent Russell.
That young O-line has got a very important man to protect today. Behind them is T.J. Yates, the quarterback. They've got to keep his jersey clean today.
They do, and it's not going to be easy. And T.J. Yates came to UNC as a redshirt freshman, broke single-season passing records, passed for 2,655 yards and 14 touchdowns. He's a proven leader. He's a guy that can get the job done, but he needs more talent around him, and he needs this inexperienced offensive line to grow up quickly. And look for John Shoup to call a lot of three-step passes, getting the ball out quickly into his playmakers on the outside.
Like that man right there, the junior Greg Little, tied for third in receptions in the conference. He's a guy that you've got to get the ball to today.
He is. I love the way he plays, and his teammates nickname him the Freak. He's played about every position in high school at Hillside High School in Durham, South Carolina. He played receiver and also running back here at UNC. He's the most experienced and reliable target for Yates to pass the ball to. He's big, he's physical, he catches the ball well with his hands, and he's active in the run game.
A lot of questions on offense for Georgia Southern as well. A guy they've also got to keep a clean jersey on, Lee Chapel. They need to get him off to a quick start, which they were able to do last week.
They were, and look at his completion rating, 67%. Last week against Wofford, completed his first 17 passes in a row, tying a SoCon conference record. But this defense at UNC, he's never seen a more talented defense. Ranked number one in the ACC in scoring, only allowing 14 points a game, and ranked fourth nationally against the pass.
And he has got a bunch of young guys to throw to. Barker, Valentine, Bryant, Taylor, a whole lot of sophomores and freshmen over on the other side.
Yeah, really unprecedented to see three true freshmen playing. Number 84, Pat Barker, number 81, Mitch Williford, number 28, Jamari Valentine. And it's tough as a true freshman to come in and play, but when you have three, it makes it even that much harder.
And then they're also young in the defensive backfield, but a little bit more experience. They have some guys that can make some plays, and they've been leading this team in tackles in the defensive secondary for GSU.
A very undersized defense. John Shoup called them almost minnows in a bucket. It starts with 13, Darius Eubanks, number 4, Derek Hayden, and then LaRon Scott and Darrell Pasco even out the cornerbacks. But even though they're undersized, these guys play hard, and they're pretty good tacklers.
And as we look towards the keys to the game for Georgia Southern, they really have got to contain North Carolina today and keep this ball game close, because that's familiar territory for them.
Well, they do, and they can't give up the big play. I mean, Georgia Southern has been talking about that all week. They really want to limit this UNC offense to just those five-yard passes. They're happy to give those up, make them take this ball down the field, not giving up those big creases and allowing for those big plays.
And then for the Tar Heels, this O-line, we've talked about how young they are. They have to come together, and they don't have a lot of time to do it. They need to get off to a big start.
There's no doubt. I mean, the biggest key for the UNC this game is the offensive line. They have to grow up quickly. They have to play much better than they played last week against Virginia.
There's the bell tower. It's hard to show up in Chapel Hill without a shot of it, and it's going to be sitting under mostly sunny skies today. Well, partially. So it was sunny until about 10 minutes ago. Now it's overcast. Going to be right around 80 degrees. Very slight breeze, if any at all. It's going to be almost a picture-perfect day for football. They prefer the Carolina blue sky here in Chapel Hill. A little bit grayer than that. But hope the sun will peek through from time to time. It was sunny here about 15 minutes ago. But that's your weather for today. And now it's time for the kickoff. We're ready to get this one underway. Georgia Southern won the toss and elected to receive. And Darrell Pasco has it back at his own 5. Looking around the end. Past the 30. Looking at him get up to the 40. Excellent starting field position for Chapel and the offense. 38 yards on the return.
Great return by Daryl Pascoe. He's averaging 22.8 yards a kickoff return. And North Carolina's coverage unit just lost contain. And that's a great way to start if you're the Eagles, getting the ball across the 40-yard line, putting your offense in great position to start off this football game.
Coach Hatcher told us he wanted to get Lee Chapel off to a quick start. You see there, 17 completed pass attempts to start the game in their win at Wofford last week. A quick pass out in the flat left side, trying to get things going early. Got Brandon Nolley out there, number 32, a quick three-yard pass. We're going to see a lot of three-, four-, five-yard pass plays for Chapel in the offense.
Yeah, we are. We're also going to see a little bit of no huddle, trying to speed up this game and not let UNC substitute on defense.
Quan Sturdivant, the middle linebacker, made the tackle. We'll see and talk about him a lot. Another quick pass, left side, another short gain as he's run out of bounds by Kendrick Burney. Another four-yard play, and that was Valentine with the catch, the freshman.
And that's what they like to do. They like these very quick passes, you know, frustrating the defense, and then all of a sudden UNC plays tight, and then they do play-action pass and try to get a deep ball over the top.
Third down and three. Crowd trying to get into it a little bit. And they'll run it to the 50 into Carolina territory. A nice job by Adam Urbano, the sophomore, and he's a guy we'll talk about a little bit. A couple of rushing touchdowns. Seventh in the SoCon in rushing, sixth in receptions per game. He'll gain 10 there and a first down.
And that's very impressive up front. I mean, man, Flowers, Dumont, Loving, Fountain, they're going against probably the most talented defensive line in the ACC with Quinn, Thomas, Austin, Wilson. And that time just really blew him off the ball and opened up some great holes for a big first down.
Very deep is this Carolina defense, and a pass that is knocked down. A nice job in coverage, Kendrick Burney. Tied for 30th in the league in tackles, but also has a bunch of passes defended as he made the stop there, incomplete. And there's Coach Chris Hatcher, third season at Georgia Southern, turning this program around. This is one of the most celebrated programs. Matter of fact, more national championships than any other FCS school, but not since 2000 have they tasted the championship victory. And he's trying to get them back, and this guy knows how to coach. He was at Valdosta State. Anybody who knows Division II football knows Valdosta State. He was a Harlan Hill trophy winner there, the nation's top Division II player. So this guy knows offense. Chapel will throw, almost picked off. Charles Brown getting in the face over there. He made the stop. Tied for fourth in the conference in interceptions. And there you see Georgia Southern. A lot of people think, oh, Appalachian State is the best FCS team because they've won titles most recently. No, 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 not so fast. In the conference, Georgia Southern has six national championships, but again, not since 2000, and that's why they brought this man in to get back to that level. Now it's third down, and they don't need three this time. They've got to get the whole 10, as you see the starters across the top of your screen. Another quick pass, but this one kind of broken up by the play, a two-yard loss as they complete it out there to Valentine again, but it was supposed to be a screen pass, and it sort of went awry on the quick throw.
Yeah, you know, an interesting play call by Rance Gillespie, the offensive coordinator, on third and long to do another short pass, and you can already see North Carolina bringing the cornerbacks up, playing cover three in the secondary, playing bump man coverage, so that they're taking away these short passes, and they're going to force Georgia Southern to throw the football downfield.
There's Charlie Edwards, a PR major. Watch out, he's going to take our jobs. Ready to punt. It's a nice high boot. This one's going to go, well, for a fair catch at the 10-yard line. So it'll be a 34-yard punt hung in the air about 3.5 seconds. And a fair catch back at their own, well, we'll call it the 11-yard line, as that man right there made the fair catch. Denoris Searcy also plays safety. So we'll get our first look at the Carolina offense. T.J. Yates, you can say about last week is ugh. No touchdowns, two picks, only 135 yards on 20 completions. The offense did not look good last week. I know you got a chance to see some of that game, and just stagnated by penalties and all kinds of mess.
They could never get into rhythm last week against Virginia.
Yates still has it. He's going to throw a little bit downfield, and the pass is caught. Ed Barham, the junior, the tight end, making the catch and a first down. He'll gain about 15 yards, and the chains move just like Carolina wants to do. We talked with Coach Shoup and Coach Davis earlier in the week, and they said, we've got to establish ourselves early. We don't have an identity right now based on the last couple of weeks.
And you see a rollout pass. I mean, there's things you can do offensively to roll out and give yourself more time to throw the football.
Butch Davis, former head coach of Cleveland in the NFL, and now a run. Drone through the middle. He'll gain about 7 on a first down carry. There's Davis again. Coach Davis, there you see, it's been... Well, not in his tenure have they not scored a touchdown in the game. Last week was the first time as he started here in 07. This is his third year at the helm of North Carolina. Hudson Presume made the tackle, but when your bandit is making tackles back there in the secondary, that's not good for your defense. Second down and a short 4 yards. Little is the man in motion from the shotgun, and they'll get it out to him. And a nice block out there by Kyle Jolly to free him on the edge, and that'll get him a first down. Nice play call there.
A good play call. I really like it. The first play of the game, they roll out. They get Yates outside the pocket. Makes a great read to Ed Barham. And then on this play, Little goes in motion, shows that it's not man coverage. Going to show a short pass out to him. And this is what he does the best, run after the catch. He's big and strong. He can break tackles, and he gets the first down.
You got to see Kyle Jolly, 72, there in your screen on the replay as this one is dropped. Jeremy Boyd dropped the pass. He's a freshman.
And Jeremy Boyd is a guy that John Shoup said is the fastest guy on this UNC football team. And he said, we got to get the ball in his hands, but he's young. He's a true freshman. And that right there, shows his immaturity.
Second 10, Yates stops. Has time. Now he's going to scramble. He's got a whole lot of green space in front of him. Run out of bounds over there by Hudson Presume, number 21, but not before Yates scrambles for 11 yards and a first down.
And Yates won't always beat you with his speed, but
no.
they call another rollout pass, and really just great coverage downfield. You see so many defensive backs for Georgia Southern. They almost play with a four-man line and the rest defensive backs, and Shoup was talking about that this week, and Yates does a great job of reading it, reversing field, getting a first down.
They basically sit you down with 3 down linemen, and then they sort of plug and play the rest of the way, and it confuses the offensive line, but not when you can run right through it like Drone just did there for 11 yards and another first down.
Yeah, and this is exactly what they need. Coming off 2 consecutive losses, you know, their confidence has been an issue, especially in the offense. I mean, defensively, they've been carrying this UNC football team, and for the opening possession to be driving the ball the way they are, that's exactly what this UNC football team needs to boost their confidence.
Yates out of the eye. Carolina offense looking good early. Send Little in motion again. They're going to go over the middle. Nice catch. Ed Barham again, the junior, over the middle. And another long play, 15 yards. This methodical offense for Carolina has a bunch of life here against the smallish defense of Georgia Southern.
You take a look, they're going to fake the reverse. It holds the linebackers. And then Ed Burham, who's primarily a blocking tight end, comes out early in this first quarter with 2 catches.
This one gets stacked up, but the pile moves all the way across the 20-yard line, an 8-yard gain for Drone. Here are the impact players for today. We talked about Little. We're seeing Drone and Ryan Houston. He's kind of a touchdown vulture. He comes in there late on goal line situations. He has the only rushing touchdowns out of the backfield for North Carolina.
Yeah, Drone does all the work, and then Houston comes in to clean up for 6.
Doesn't seem fair. Second down and a long 1 yard. To the left side, over the left guard, left tackle. Drone again. He'll be close to it. Down near the 17-yard line, Deion DeBose made the stop for Georgia Southern.
DeBose is their Mike linebacker, really one of the defensive leaders for the Eagles. 6 foot, 217 pounds. Still, for a middle linebacker, 217 pounds is still, you know, a bit undersized, but he's a disciplined tackler and a vocal leader for this defense.
Butch Davis didn't like the spot. It'll be third down and some inches. And this is, believe it or not, the first third down play today on this drive for North Carolina, which started back at their own 11. Right side, this is definitely a first down. As a helmet has come off. That's Houston coming in to get the first down. The rover, Darius Eubanks, lost his helmet.
You're going to just see power football. Jolly, Ellaby, Holland, Pollock, Ingersoll pushing the pile, giving Drone, you know, enough room to get a first down.
There you get a shot of Ryan Houston. Here's the 11th play of the drive coming up in the red zone where North Carolina is 10 out of 12 on the season. Houston with the carry. You note him by his flowing locks coming out of the back of that helmet. He's from Charlotte, played at Butler High School.
And that is a big physical running back, 6'2", 245 pounds. The linebackers for Georgia Southern go 200, 217, and a buck 90 at the rover position. So if you're, you know, Ryan Houston, you love going against an undersized defense like this. You can power your way, power football all day.
Doesn't have to make the first man miss today. You can just bowl over the first man. Yates on the rollout. Receiver knocked down. They'll go to the end zone, to the corner. Incomplete. There is a flag on the far sideline, and that might be what I was talking about earlier, where the receiver was kind of swallowed up and taken down as he was trying to split out wide. Let's see what the ACC crew has for us. Jerry Magaline's the official today. They go against the Eagles. Coach Hatcher looking on.
Well, let's take a look where the foul occurred. He was trying, Yates was trying to get the ball in the hands of Highsmith, but just great coverage by number 9, Darryl Pass.
On the defense, that penalty is half the distance to the goal from the line of scrimmage. Second down.
Devin Ramsey was the man trying to split out there, and he just sort of got bowled over.
And Coach Hatcher is not happy with that call. It was tough to see it on the replay as well. But nevertheless.
Yeah, second and short now inside the 5. If inside the 20 is the red zone, I've heard inside the 10 called the green zone. I don't know what inside the 5 is. That's just goal line. Punch it in. That's what they want. This crowd wants to see it. Could not score a touchdown last week. Houston trying to slip through there. Swallowed up around the 2-yard line. Tackle error by Benefield. Andrew Bose. And that's a first down. So Carolina will have 4 cracks at it at around the 2-yard line. And that man right there, Houston, 13 touchdown runs of just 35 yards. He's the goal line guy. And he's the guy Drone is glad to have in his backfield. He'll say that out loud, but I'm sure he's like, come on, that guy's taking my scores away from him. A tap. Yates taking himself. Oh, he'll be down short of the goal line. A nice stop by Dubose. We talked about him, the middle linebacker, 12th in the SoCon in tackling, and he had to make the tackle here.
It looks like a little option route. He's going to roll out, sees everyone's covered, and thinks he can just get in the end zone, but a good downhill tackle right there by number 33, Deion Dubose.
Dubose leads in tackles with 40. Coming into this game, another goal line situation, second and goal. There's Houston, runs into his own man, stretches it out, and they give it to him. Touchdown, North Carolina, the 5th of the season for Ryan Houston. And the first in 2 weeks.
No, exactly what they needed, and you know, especially in watching that game last week against Virginia, their offense was embarrassed. They could not get a first down. They had 4 punts in the first quarter, and they could not get into a rhythm, and they did a great job moving the football down. Yates and Drone and Houston, just power football.
Extra point up and good for Casey Barth. You saw on the replay, Alan Pelt ran out there and led the way to the end zone, where Houston gives North Carolina a 7-0 lead. Ryan Houston punches it in from 1 yard out. The longest scoring drive of the season for North Carolina. They marched 89 yards on 14 plays, and I believe they only had one third down play on the drive. Just one. And all of his touchdowns are of 5 yards or less. He is what you call a touchdown vulture. But he won't argue with you. They'll kick it off again back at the 5 yard line for Georgia Southern. A bounce and taken down at the 16 yard line. 12 yard return as the tackle for North Carolina, Herman Davidson. And Hunter Furr in on the stop for the Tar Heels. And so another chance for Chapel and the offense, which got past midfield but stalled because of some drops. Important for them to get off to a start here.
Yeah, they're probably going to have to open up a little bit. I mean, they like the short passes, but, you know, on third and long, it's tough to run a short, you know, a receiver screen and have a lot of success against this UNC defense.
So they'll run it on first down. Urbano trying to cut the corner, but he'll only get a yard or two as we take a look at the impact players today for Georgia Southern. Urbano averaging nearly 100 total yards per game. And there you see Robinson, the tailback, and Valentine, the wideout. Really in their backfield. Chapel's a sophomore. Robinson, a freshman. Urbano, a sophomore. Barker, Valentine, freshman. Williford, freshman. I mean, this is young offense.
Two sophomores on the offensive line as well.
A little bit of jumping up front. And there are flags out as the pass down the left sideline is caught but out of bounds by Patrick Barker. You see the hanky on the field.
Offside, number 9 of the defense. 5 yards, replay second down.
We'll get Marvin Austin, the left tackle, defensive tackle. Coach Davis, I'm watching you. No, he says watch the ball. You're right over the ball.
Big number 9, 6'3", 305. He's a junior, big presence in the middle. And Coach Davis told us this week that he really is the vocal leader of this very good North Carolina defense.
The least penalized team in the conference. Going with 3 down linemen right now. Creeping up 2 guys. From the shotgun, Chapel spins and fires to the outside. And this will be close to a first down. I believe on second effort he might have it. A nice catch over there by Mitchell Williford, the freshman. 162 yards coming into this game. Tack on 4 more out of Duluth, Georgia. Tackle there by Austin, who ran him down from his defensive lineman position.
Yeah, defensive coordinator Everett Withers just dialed up a blitz on the outside. Zach Brown blitz, and they caught him in a blitz. But Marvin Austin showed you his speed for a big guy to out there and make that tackle.
305 pounds running you down from behind. That's tough to do. Another quick pass. This is Garyon Taylor. Taylor will squirt it to the outside and be close to a first down again. And they will give it to him, a 10-yard reception. And here's that dink and dunk we talked about, Jeremy. This is right up your alley as a wideout, getting a 3-yard pass and turning it into 10, meaning these guys can do something with the ball once they have it out in space.
Oh, you love it as a receiver because you frustrate the defense, and then all of a sudden you do a pump and go, and you can have a big play.
Urbano trying to find some space to the right side. If he saw daylight, I didn't see that as well. He may have gotten a yard, just got back to the line of scrimmage. And big Cam Thomas making the stop, the right tackle. No gain on the play.
And what showed up on film so much for this UNC defense is how good these defensive linemen are. They don't even have to blitz. They don't dial up a lot of blitzes. This front four can get after the quarterback just by themselves.
Coach Williams said they just keep it simple. As they'll run up to the line and now get a signal from the sideline. You saw the numbers for Urbano, 5.1 yards per carry this season. Today, not so much. 3 carries, 11 yards. And a timeout called by the far sideline as Georgia Southern wasn't quite sure what they had dialed up on a second down and 10. They're moving the chains, but they want to make sure they keep moving them here. Down 7-0, late stages of the first quarter. Chris Hatcher, the head coach of Georgia Southern, Not many people know he was the architect behind the largest fourth quarter comeback in NCAA history. And should we need that in the fourth, we'll talk about it then. And a pass play on second down as Chapel was looking for Jonathan Bryant, just a hair too high for him. He's only 5'10", 150. And there's Quan Sturdivant out there in coverage, the middle linebacker, trying to cover a wideout.
And Chapel had his guy. Jonathan broke free in the secondary, ran a quick hitch route, and found the void in the zone, but just a little too strong on the throw by Chapel.
36.8% converting third downs. They've done it once today in two tries. But the one they failed on was also a third and 10. A hitch, a hit, the ball's up in the air, and it's rolling toward the sideline. It's a live football. Carolina's got it. Going down the far sideline, Robert, or rather E.J. Wilson, number 92. Robert Quinn was there to make a big hit.
I love the call. Straight man, bump man across the board with safety over the top help. And look at the front four just dominate the line and get after it. I mean, that is the play. Those are the plays you want to see. Robert Quinn is a stud, 6'5", 260 sophomore. And Coach Davis was talking to his team last week when they played Virginia and said, hey, in 2001, the Baltimore Ravens, the offense didn't score in seven games, but their defense played so well, special teams played so well, they won the Super Bowl that year. And he really wants to motivate his offense and defense and these guys to believe that even though they struggled last week against Virginia, their offense, but they can still win and get the job done. And you see the leadership and the talent on this UNC defense.
They are reviewing this play to see if Chapel's arm was going forward to see if that was an incomplete pass or a fumble. The hit made by Robert Quinn, who is first in the ACC in tackles for loss.
After review,
second
and the ruling
sacks
on the field is confirmed. It was a fumble recovered by North Carolina. First down.
Second in the league in sacks. That'll go down as a sack. He's tied for third and forced fumbles. Now he's got three. And Wilson, his teammate on the D-line, returned the ball 12 yards.
And he also broke a very famous record here, Julius Peppers' 40-yard dash time at 4.5 seconds for a 260-pound defensive end, and he's only a sophomore.
You saw tied for eighth in all of NCAA football for tackles for loss. And here going down for his first touchdown of the season, Sean Drone. I don't need no stinking Houston to run it in. For me, I'll do it myself.
And that's how you get touchdowns. He almost got caught on the 2-yard line or 3-yard line and put his head down and said, look, I need a touchdown.
I will not be denied.
They keep bringing in this Houston guy. No, I got this one. And there's just a great second effort right there to get into the end zone.
16 yards for the score. The snap was a bit high, but a nice job putting it down. And Casey Barth punches it through. Even though the defense didn't score it for them, they got the ball for the offense. And Sean Drone punches it in on a 16-yard run to give North Carolina a 2-touchdown lead. Unfortunately for Georgia Southern, North Carolina arrived at the ballpark today with a nasty disposition and 4+ quarters without scoring a touchdown already here in the first. 2 touchdowns, including Sean Drone's first of the season. Both of the tailbacks have one apiece, making up for last week. Unfortunately, you can't score enough on Georgia Southern that they go back and give you the win over Virginia, but that's kind of what it appears North Carolina is trying to do here. No touchdowns last week, 2 already here, and we haven't finished the first quarter yet as the flags fly as gentlemen from the home team are offside.
Delay game on a kicking team. 5 yards, free kick.
Or they took too long. You don't usually see delay of game on the kickoff.
I don't know if I've really ever seen it in playing all my years in playing. When they threw the flag and blew the whistle, I was kind of confused. At first I thought it might have been offsides, but they don't blow that dead. They'll continue the play, but You definitely don't see that a lot. And maybe Butch Davis is saying to himself, what is going on? I've coached in football for the last 30-some years, and I've never seen that. What, the play clock broken or something? He's pleading his case.
Yeah, I don't remember ever seeing that at any level of football. Delay of game on the kickoff. Interesting. All right. So they'll march it back five and kick off from the 25-yard line, rather. The old backyard do-over. Returning from the 16-yard line, a crease and another return up to the 41. They have not blown this dead yet, as Carolina picked it up and ran the other way, but I think they are going to say down. And the line judge comes out and says, ball on the 39, first down the other way, 23-yard return, as Georgia Southern will have it on the 39-yard line. Kennedy Tinsley on the stop. Here's the play. Well down before the ball comes out.
And you said it best, that UNC team just looks angry. I mean, that was a nice return. He had a nice hole. But if you watch the coverage unit as a whole, they are rolling guys out there playing downhill football.
First down and 10 for Chapel. Back out there to try to move the chains. And on the first play on this drive, they'll get close to 8 yards. As we take a look at what happened last time he had the ball. Very last time he touched the ball, this is what happened.
Robert Quinn coming from the outside. We talked about him, 6'5", 260. And he moves, and then Drone says, I don't want anyone coming in and scoring my touchdowns. This is mine. I'll take the first touchdown of the season.
I will run it to the right side. A whole lot of Robert Quinn is what happened, basically. And then a little bit of Sean Drone to finish it off. And this is, look at this. I mean, that's not conference rank. That's all football. Fourth in pass defense, fourth in tackles for loss, eighth overall in yardage, and 15th in scoring. That's all 120 teams right there. That is getting it done. And they credit those guys up front, as Chapel will sneak it across the line to gain and up to midfield for the first down. So the chains will move, and this will be really the second time that Georgia Southern has breached Carolina territory. They just have no points to show for it. Bruce Carter on the stop, the junior strong side linebacker, as guys were offside there. They're going to go ahead and try for broke up the sideline, tipped away by Charles Brown, who got a paw on it. But a flag down, and this will probably cost Carolina 5 yards.
Offside, number 42 of the defense. 5 yards, first down.
And that's Robert Quinn just getting a little ahead of himself, a little eager to get to Chapel and make another play. And just a free play, but a good coverage, very good coverage by number 12, the 5'9". 190-pound junior Charles Brown.
Good steady cornerback play on this defense. And you got to have that if you're going to let your defensive line get to work. Urbano into the open field, off to the races, and he's got a touchdown. 45 yards. Well, that happened quickly. That escalated quickly.
And he showed his speed right there. I mean, at 5'8", 190 pounds as a sophomore, it's just an option route. He can hand it off or run it. He sees 42 Quinn come outside, and a great job blocking up front. And then he shows his speed right here. I mean, you're not going to catch him when you get him in space, and a heck of a play.
Well, I was talking earlier about he's not at his 5-yard average today. Well, 4 carries, 56 yards, so even 14 per. Plus some change. The extra point up and good for Adrian Mora. And all of a sudden, Georgia Southern decides to make a game of it. As Urbano just slipped in that little crease off the little bounce by Zach Brown. He didn't wrap up, so Urbano was off to the races. His third touchdown of the year. that's a nice shot in the arm for Georgia Southern. They needed some confidence builder right
there. Oh, they absolutely did not have momentum on the side. The crowd was getting into it. They needed that touchdown. But back to Chris Hatcher. I mean, this guy played at Valdosta State, two-time All-American. He threw for over 10,000 yards as a player. And when you're a player and you have a head coach that's done it on the field, he just has another level of respect. When he's in front of you in team meetings talking about how we have to win football games, it's just another level when he's been, when he's done it himself.
It's easy to buy into it when he's doing what he's doing. Four plays, 61 yards, a little less than a minute and a half, and that'll be the career-long run for Urbano. 45 yards. He's just a sophomore. The future is well ahead of this kid, and the Southern Conference has got to take notice if they haven't already. Kickoff for North Carolina, taken back at the 11-yard line. Little. Snowed under around the 25, a 15-yard return, and that's where North Carolina will get it started. Hey, much more action to come here on ESPN 360. More ACC play this evening. Following us, right around 6:30, it'll be Maryland taking on Wake Forest. That's a pretty big game for those two teams, trying to creep up out of the cellar and establish themselves in the middle of their divisions. And then Miami will host Florida A&M in who I think, well, actually those two games feature, in my opinion, the best two quarterbacks in the league, Riley Skinner at Wake Forest and Harris at Miami. Two excellent quarterbacks in this conference as the run play for Drone will be ridden out of bounds around the 35-yard line. Give him 7 yards, but Yates may eventually step into that better quarterback in the league roles, but those two guys, Skinner and Harris, probably the best two quarterbacks in the ACC. Yates, well, he was looking to his right. Now he's going to try to turn the corner, and he can't do it. He'll be taken down for a loss of at least 2, maybe 3 yards. 2-yard loss there on second down. And the tackle and the pursuit made by Benefield, number 22, the weak side linebacker, Terrion Benefield.
Both teams playing a very fast tempo offense. The Eagles with the no huddle, but UNC's wasting no time.
Big third down here for Carolina. From the 30. Yates over the middle, and the receiver won't be able to get there, I don't believe. Dwight Jones, the sophomore, was spun around. He'll gain 4, and he'll be a yard shy. And here comes Houston into the game, so it doesn't look like they'll punt.
And Jones, that's a spacing route. That's a zone beater. And as a receiver, he's only a sophomore, once a junior, senior. Well, you have to get to the sticks. If you're setting that route down, you got to extend that 2 more yards, give your quarterback that target, and get that first down.
North Carolina tied for first in the conference in fourth down conversions. They are 4 of 6. They need 1 yard. Maybe try to draw him offside, so they'll go ahead and run it. And Houston bounces through over to the 37-yard line. Give him 3. He needed 1, and it's a first down.
I mean, you want to talk about a change in confidence? Last week, this is a football team that could go nowhere against Virginia. And Coach Davis shows the confidence he has in his offense right here to go for it on fourth and down inside their own territory.
Yeah, that's a risky play if you don't make it, no doubt. Playing the part of the riverboat gambler right there. But he got the 3 yards and a first down. Fake on the pop-out play and throw it out in the flats. Houston out of the backfield makes the catch and runs it near midfield. 13 yards and another Carolina first down as Yates runs up to the line and tells his guys to let's go, let's settle down.
Another great play fake on the fake reverse, and then you're going to see Houston do the rest. Watch him not go out of bounds. He loves contact. He wants to hit people. He's not going to run out of bounds.
Williams made the tackle. Harlan Bauer was in there adding pressure on Yates. As Houston makes the carry there, Derek Hayden, number 4, the free safety, up to make the stop after a gain of 3.
And Derek Hayden's a sophomore. Last year he was named to the SoCon All-Freshman Team, 6'1", 175-pound sophomore. He's got a bright future for the Eagles.
In the top 30 in tackles in the SoCon so far this season. He's also forced a fumble. Could be the last play of the quarter as the clock continues to wind down. Houston over the middle, across the 45 to the 44, 3 yards on the carry. Carolina, how about this? Already has more first downs in the first quarter than they did against Virginia in the entire game last week. They have 10 first downs. And appropriately, that's the end of the first quarter. So 10 first downs is what they've got. And they've got a one touchdown lead. We'll reset the clock. The teams will walk all of 10 yards on the other side, and Carolina will still have it driving up by a touchdown. Not a bad day so far for these two teams. North Carolina, a couple of touchdowns on the ground. Yates, 5 out of 6 for 50 yards. Chapel for Georgia Southern, 7 out of 10. Not bad. Good start. Welcome inside Keenan Stadium, Chapel Hill, North Carolina. Ryan Rose and Jeremy Bloom, thanks for clicking over and checking us out on ESPN 360. Exclusive presentation of college football. And a little dump-off screen that snuffed out well by the defense of Georgia Southern, as Benefield was there to make the stop, a 6-yard loss to Drone. And that will get the Tar Heels off the field as we take a look at the first quarter stats. And a little bit misleading because Carolina played with a short field of one possession, but they did drive it 89 yards on their first possession of the half. And from midfield, the Tar Heels will have to punt, waiting the play clock out. Not a great one, caught on the run at the 20-yard line, and this will be decent starting field position. When you're on the 50-yard line, you expect to pin the opponent deep. But a 31-yard return, or excuse me, a 12-yard return after a 31-yard punt. Return down there by Ronnie Wiggins.
Ronnie Wiggins, and as a punt returner, those are the punts that your eyes get so big because they're line drives, and you know you're going to catch the football with space and a good return. But you got to be careful if you're North Carolina. You got to get the ball in the air. Otherwise, you give that returner a great opportunity, you know, to take one to the house.
Pick his lanes, and I probably will pick your brain about that a little bit later. Again, right up your alley, being that kamikaze guy out by himself trying to find his blocks going up the field. A 2-yard loss as there's that man again, Quan Sturdivant, the middle linebacker for North Carolina. They moved him to the Mike linebacker at the bowl game last year, and they have all the confidence in the world of this guy. He's leading him in tackles coming into the game with 34. So second down and 12. Another run. Urbano to the 40. And he'll get to the 41. So he got back the 2-yard loss and maybe 9 more. He'll be a yard shy, and I like how they're using him in different ways to get him the ball.
Urbano's been impressive, but look at the hole he has to run through. I mean, that's a great job. Man on the outside, Flowers on the outside, up front, you know, pushing a great defensive line around and opening the holes. But he's been impressive. I mean, 5 rushes, 67 yards and a touchdown against one of the best defenses in the ACC. That's impressive.
I'm sure they didn't expect that kind of day from him. Now he catches the pass, or excuse me, catching the pass out on the outside, number 84, Patrick Barker, and it goes for a loss thanks to heads-up play by Kennedy Tinsley.
And Tinsley, that's another tackle for a loss. This is a team that's ranked fourth nationally, averaging 9.5 tackles for a loss a game, ranked first in the ACC, and Tinsley, he got the job done, another tackle for a loss.
Already you see the numbers for North Carolina from 08 to 09. They have made dramatic improvements in those two categories. Carolina will put a deep man, and then they'll put a not-so-deep man in case things don't go well, and also to help block. They'll let it go, and it'll bounce out of bounds at the 10, but let's see where they rule it out of bounds. It'll go at the 12, and that's where Chapel Hill's North Carolina Tar Heels will have to start their next drive. Not a problem. They've already driven it once for 89 yards. Chris Hatcher, the head coach of Georgia Southern, trying to figure out how they can get back into the end zone down a touchdown. Now, the last time North Carolina started a drive inside of its own 15, they marched it 89 yards. 6 out of 7 is T.J. Yates so far. Good start for him. And the pass he didn't complete was dropped, so had a nice start. They're going to let him go here. He's in the grass, but catch made by Drone, and he's going to turn into a first down. Well, that play was going for nothing, and he turned it into 17 yards. What looked like should have been a sack turned into a 17-yard gain. LaRon Scott made the hit.
You're going to see 47 Bauer come in and just grab him by the ankles, but Yates does a great job of evading the rush and getting the ball out, holding his composure. You know, last week he was hit around so much that he almost got happy feet in the pocket, but was able to get out the Drone that time. Great job.
You can't blame him for getting happy feet as much as he was being brought to the turf. And this play is kind of busted up as the defensive line got through. J.B. Shippey, a backup linebacker, made the stop. It'll be a loss of a yard.
And no, you can't blame him for the happy feet that he had last week. And he's gotten too much criticism over the past couple weeks. And, you know, his offensive line hasn't been playing great. They're doing a much better job today. But he is a redshirt freshman. He broke single-season records. The guy can get the job done.
And the coaching staff has all the confidence in the world in him. He's staying back there and making the plays he's asked to make. Pass to Christian Wilson out to the left side. Backup tight end sophomore. No gain. So third down and long for North Carolina. J.B. Shippey there again. There's Wilson. From Pennsylvania way. A lot of NFL coaches on this staff as Carolina will try to convert its second third down of the game. He's going to go for all of it. Overthrows his intended receiver on the far sideline. Looking for Greg Little. He's the guy I'd be looking for, too. He's got as sure of hands as most guys in this league, but the H just overthrows it.
No, on third down, that's exactly who you want to look for. But great coverage by number 4, Derek Hyden. Really stayed with Little step to step. And, again, Hyden, we mentioned him earlier. Last year, as a true freshman, he was named all-freshman team and doing a great job here.
Check out this guy, Grant Shalit. 6'7", punting it away for the Tar Heels. Plays a little hoops. A little. A high punt, not very deep. Taken back at the 30, and a big old two-point takedown after the 39-yard punt. And that's not much of a return as Johnny White with a suplex. He needed a top rope to finish that play.
Johnny White, 5'10", 205. And I love to see punt returners not call a fair catch. I love to see it. I mean, it shows their toughness, but... That's a wrestling move right there. He might be a WWE fan. Picked that one up from Vince McMahon and some of those guys. But, you know, just a great job at this gunner position and making the tackle.
Just looking around thinking there's a chair or a table coming at you after that one.
And those are the plays that excite the sideline. Look at the guys on the sideline high-fiving. I mean, little plays like that can make a big difference.
Fake it to Urbano, and Chapel will keep it. Up the left side for a modest gain. Trying to throw a little wrinkle in there as Robert Quinn was in the area to make the stop. He wasn't fooled. He was staying after the quarterback in Chapel. They've had a little early success trying to tie this game up on a drive. The defense has done quite well for Georgia Southern today. They might be a little smaller, but they're using their speed a little bit, helping to contain North Carolina. Second and 6. Tipped and incomplete. Almost picked off by Bruce Carter. And Kendrick Burney jumping in there.
Yeah, take a look. Number 54, Bruce Carter, does a great job just eyeing the... Look at it, viewing the eyes of Chapel the whole way, and was really a fingertip away from an interception, and he had nobody in front of him.
Chapel was kind of locked in there to Patrick Barker. He's got a fake with his head a little bit. 2 out of 5 on third down. They'll try for another conversion here. Urbano will get close, but I think he'll be short by a half yard. More helmets flying off down there. Marvin Austin's lid came off. Unfortunately for Georgia Southern, he's just as scary with it off as with it on. That guy, he doesn't care. He's going to come in and lay a lick to you.
That is a big presence on the inside. Run stopper, and here we go. Another fourth down conversion here.
Going to go for it. You're thinking Chapel. He's found a seam. He will be very close. At first blush, it looked like he got bounced back, but he slid down the line to the right side, and it appeared that he might have gotten it. Yes, he did.
It was a great second effort. I mean, to run a quarterback sneak is a risky proposition against this front four, and it looked like they had blown up the play, but he found a little hole off the right-hand side and was able to sneak his way in there for a first down.
First and 10, nose of the football just over the 40. Urbano. Boy, he just keeps finding holes and seams and slips through. Just 5'6", so he's hard to find. Gets up a little bit slowly, and all kinds of gear issues there as he got smashed to the ground after a gain of a long 7, call it 8 yards. When everybody's standing up around the line, he's hard a guy to locate. By the time you see him, he's by you. And there he goes to the left side. He got stripped. North Carolina's got it, and the defense is going to score a touchdown. Just had it taken away. Quan Sturdivant comes out of the scrum with the football, and the Tar Heels have a defensive touchdown.
52, Quan
Well, let's take a look at Urbano. This might be out of fatigue. He's tired, but Sturdivant does just a great job, says, give me that football, and then takes it the distance. Nobody in front of him. What a great play. And Sturdivant is as strong as they come as a middle linebacker and just took that football.
Well, they told us he had great movement boundary to boundary. They didn't say when he got to the tackler, when he got to make the tackle, he'd arrive with a nasty disposition. He's all greedy, and he scores a touchdown. A 49-yard fumble return for touchdown, the fifth longest fumble return in school history. And I made a lot of notes on that, man. Let me add one more to it. Does not share well with others. Greedy takes the football.
That's what you want out of a middle linebacker.
He just stripped the running back, Urbano, and ran it back 49 yards for the score. So we thought the defense could hold and keep it a close game. Well, the defense went ahead and made some scoring of their own. And the special teams unit trying to do more of the same. Trying to strip that ball out as the return got to the 17-yard line.
Well, let's take another look at it. You're going to see Urbano. I mean, they've been having so much success with him, relying on him. It just looks like he gets lazy. And Sturdivant just takes the football, and he's the leader. He's the Mike, 6'2", 230 junior. He is the leader of this defense, does a great job. And, again, that's what this defense has to do. They have to carry this UNC football team as they continue on today, but also in ACC schedule. They're going to have to continue plays like that, big turnovers, score some points for this offense.
Well, in those days that the offense isn't firing on all cylinders, some days the defense may have to actually do that, score some points for the offense. They'll give it right back to Urbano, making sure that he and the rest of the offense knows they've got confidence. They know he's going to be the man. 3 yards on the carry for him. Tackle made by Bruce Carter. You worry about confidence being shaken a little bit. Young guy, just a sophomore, but he's too important for this team not to be a major part of the offense. Second down, 7. Chapel signals to his receivers. Changing the call up. He's running out of time. Doesn't have a lot of time to throw it. And this one's picked off. No, it's not. It's incomplete. Now it is picked off. He's down. Nice catch. A pickoff by Zach Brown, number 47. And things are completely falling apart here for the Eagles. A dive and a catch as Brown dove in front of that route. We saw Carter jump in front of the route on the last possession. Now Brown on the other side of the linebacker core does the same thing.
And it was just straight pump man coverage. You're going to take another look at it. Brown was lined up on the outside, and I was very surprised it didn't go deep. And a great catch there by Brown, but his knee came down. But
trying to hit Brandon Nolley in another short field for North Carolina.
But on that last play, the North Carolina defense came up, bump man coverage with just one single safety playing center field. And usually, I mean, back in my playing days at Colorado in the NFL, when you see that bump man coverage, really no one under the top, you run a go.
It's automatic.
And yep. It's automatic. You run a go, and they tried to run a short pattern, and the defensive backs for UNC just stayed, and the linebackers stayed right there with the receivers.
One interception and two fumbles have resulted in a pair of touchdowns, one scored directly by the defense, the other by the offense. As another first down play for North Carolina, getting in some of the backup guys, a 12-yard completion, and a first down.
And offensive coordinator John Shoup said that's what they like to do at North Carolina. They like to play a lot of people. They almost use the game as ability to grow with these younger players and get them in the football game.
Devin Ramsey, tackle made by LaRon Scott. Here's Houston again. Houston is creating a problem. He has two touchdowns today. Finally, one of more than 5 yards. His longest of the season. Longest of his career. Can you believe that?
Oh, 7 yards. Look at the run, though. Look at the power, the spin move, the body control, the vision, and then the strength to get in the end zone.
He should have been down three separate times on that play, but as Jeremy said, he pinballed his way into the end zone. 28-7, and the wheels have come off the Eagles' wagon as North Carolina is rolling it up here in the second quarter. Quite a few upsets around the country today, but not here. North Carolina doing what it's expected to do today, although in a little bit brash fashion, scoring three touchdowns off of Georgia Southern turnovers, two runs, and a fumble recovery. One of the runs coming on the very next play. Longest career touchdown for Ryan Houston. Just 7 yards. His second score today. North Carolina 28-7. Tar Heels kick it away again. It's a deep kick. It's going to come out for a touchback. Here's Ryan Houston's run of, really, you can call it 2, 2, and 3 yards because he gets stopped twice.
I mean, this guy reminds me of Brandon Jacobs for the New York Giants. He's big, he's powerful, he's strong, and I think the only reason that's the longest run in his career because he hasn't been put in the position to do it. I mean, I think he's got all the intangibles. I'd love to see him get out in space and see how fast the guy is, but, you know, for just a junior, he's got next year, he could be an absolute pro prospect.
He ran all over guys in the Southwestern Conference in high school. I remember covering him, and just as a sophomore, he was rolling up 20 touchdowns a year. And it didn't seem like the next level was that much more of a challenge for him so far. Urbano will slide up across the 20 to the 23-yard line. Robert Quinn there, number 42, there to make the stop. Not padding his stats, he is legitimate. Awesome lineman. And from his defensive end position, doing a lot of tackling today. Urbano again. That was Quinn that held him up in the backfield for his teammates to come in and make the stop. Cam Thomas, 93. He got over there for a 1 yard loss on the play. And he showed up with a bit of vinegar in his blood.
And how many times have we seen that play call? You know, I mean, Rance Gillespie wants to go with what's working, but Urbano off the left-hand side, I mean, it's going to hit repeat, and that time Cam Thomas says, we know this play. We've seen it a few times. Another tackle for a loss for this defense.
Third down and 8. A couple of runs for Urbano on this drive. Another third down try for GSU. Two out of six today. All kinds of pressure. A screen, a dump off. Flags come out of the backfield. Urbano is swallowed up and blasted over at the 37-yard line. A little bit of extra after the play, but cooler heads will prevail as they separate the folks. Helmets came flying out. The ball was flying around in there. All kinds of sporting equipment. Loose.
Personal foul. Roughing the passer. Number 98 of the defense. 15 yards from the end of the run. First down.
It can get a little excited at the end of a play. Dante Page Moss, backup defensive end. That will hurt the ability to draw a punt. It'll be first down and 10 all the way out to the 43. Picked off again. And this one is also going to go for a touchdown. Bruce Carter got out in front of an earlier pass, just couldn't wrangle it in. This time he picked it off and took it to the house. Wow. Boy, they look good on paper, but in person, this Carolina defense is as advertised.
Coach Hatcher's going to lose a gasket here. I mean, Bruce Carter, like you said, stepped in front of another pass, almost had it for a touchdown, and he said, this time, I'm going to take it all the way. And this defense, I mean, how good are they?
They're legit. I would put them up with Clemson as perhaps some of the best, especially on the front, defensive linemen, linebackers in this league. Now, maybe I'm ahead of myself because they're facing a FCS opponent, but you still have to make the plays. You still have to jump the routes. You still have to strip the football.
Well, this is exactly what this football team needed. I mean, coming after 2 weeks of a lot of criticism, of not playing great football, of not getting in rhythm on offense, defense trying to carry them but just couldn't squeeze out the wins. This, I mean, in looking at the schedule, you kind of look at the, you know, the beginning of the season, say Georgia Southern all the way down here on the schedule. I mean, why are we doing that? But this could not have come at a better time for this football team to play this way, to get confidence back heading into a rough schedule coming up.
Well, the prognosis for North Carolina was bleak for the way the season was going, but pick two of these to the house, take a bye week, and call me in the morning. They have
and the bye week
the recipe.
And the bye week couldn't have come at a better time as well.
The kickoff for Georgia Southern back at the 6-yard line. And the returner gets it out to the 23-yard line. It was Ronnie Wiggins taking it up. He's the seventh best kick returner in the conference. He'll go for 18 yards there as Melvin Williams there to make the hit along with Jonathan Smith. So a first down and 10 for Georgia Southern as Chapel and the offense has got to climb out of this funk they're in right now. Two picks for touchdown, or one pick for touchdown, one fumble recovery for touchdown, a second pick. The linebackers have two interceptions today. One from the strong side, Carter, one from the weak side, and Zach Brown. And another run. Fumble, interception, interception, the last three Eagles possessions.
Yeah, these linebackers have been just playing lights out football, exactly how you want your linebackers to play, and the defensive line have been putting enough pressure on the quarterback for him to get into these errant situations, throw these balls quicker than he wants to, and Chapel's definitely made some mistakes, and UNC's made him pay for it.
5-yard gain, Tydreek Powell on the stop, the backup defensive left tackle. And another run. Zeke Rozier with the run. Getting his third and fourth carries of the season. Here's what's upcoming for North Carolina. They've got Florida State, and then they're at Virginia Tech. So that bye week, as Jeremy said, huge for them to watch some film on themselves, get well, get healthy, try to get some of the offensive linemen back that are down, because that's a rough patch right there. You get FSU here, and FSU's reeling a little bit as Urbano carries it on third down, close to the first down yardage. But North Carolina's got had some questions they need answered, and they got some of them answered here today so far.
Well, and I think the biggest thing is confidence, and it starts with T.J. Yates. When, as a quarterback, it doesn't matter really who you are. I mean, a lot of times in football, players get too much credit. A lot of times quarterbacks get too much credit and too much blame when things aren't going well. You need to have an offensive line. I don't care if you're Tom Brady. If you don't have time to throw the football, you're not going to win football games. T.J. Yates is getting confidence in his offensive line this week, and he's going to be able to carry that into next week, you know, into this bye week, and then into the week against Florida State and Virginia Tech, where they're going to need that confidence. We all saw what Virginia Tech did to Boston College today.
Fourth down and a yard, and Georgia Southern will call timeout to sort things out. This is, if they're going to have any chance of coming back in this game, they've got to convert this play right here. I hate to put it all on one play, but this is what they want to do. Running out of time in the half.
Well, you talked about the comeback that Hatcher, the Hatch Attack, led, and he's probably going to bring that up at halftime and say, hey, guys, you know,
we've done it before.
We've been in this situation before. We didn't play good football. We made a ton of mistakes. It's not just that UNC's playing so well. Georgia Southern's gave them those opportunities. They've been beating themselves with errant throws, and they have a lot of room for improvement in the second half. And if, you know, Coach Hatcher can get in front of those guys and say, look, we've done this before, we can do it again, who knows? But with the way UNC's defense and now offense is clicking, I think it's going to be very difficult for them to do that in the second half.
Well, plus you just might say, look, scoreboard 0-0, let's work on just improving in the second half. This is a hard defense to work anything out against. I mean, let's be fair. This isn't just an FBS defense. This is one of the best FBS defenses in the country coming into this week. And they will punt. The old rugby punt. The run and kick deal where he tried to angle it toward the sidelines, but punt returner got himself some space and turned it around a little bit as Denoris Searcy brought it up after a 43-yard kick.
And another line drive kick, and Searcy is a great punt returner. I mean, you want to know how many great punt returners are in the ACC? He's fourth in the ACC, but eighth nationally. With a 16.5-yard average, and a lot of great punt returns in the ACC in that time. You know, he tried to take advantage of. But, again, it is a team game. You can be the best returner in the country. You got to have the 10 guys in front of you giving you a few lanes and making a couple guys miss yourself.
Yates, 9 out of 11, hasn't been asked to do a whole lot today. They've kept the game simple. Well, he's going to go for broke here right down the middle. Man open, a dive, and he can't come down with it. Of course, that's Little, their big play receiver, trying for the big bomb. LaRon Scott was in the vicinity, but the only guy who could have caught this was Little.
They were going for it all, and Little had his man beat by 3, 4, 5 steps, and just a little bit too much on the ball for Yates that time. You hate that as a receiver. I can't. You just walk back to the sideline when you're that open and you're so close to catching that big play. Like John Shoup said all week, they wanted to hit those big seams. That was so close.
And you know, you're that open. I beat my man. I did my job. That's just Yates, and I think Yates and Little are still figuring out each other at this stage of the season. They've got some time. They've got the rest of this year and next year. And I expect to see some big things out of these two the rest of this season. DeBose came up and disrupted things. Third down, they'll go the end around. Nice play for a first down as Jeremy Boyd out to the left side, 11-yard carry. DeBose again on the stop for Georgia Southern.
and you brought up next year and looking at these this receiving core and the fact that Yates is going to get come back, Little's going to come back, Jeremy Boyd, who just caught that pass, he's the fastest guy on the team as a true freshman, and Highsmith. We haven't talked about a lot about him today, but he is a young prospect that has a very bright future.
Well, Barham, the tight end, also a junior, so they do have the prospects of the future being bright as Yates is down in the backfield. Rolling by him quickly, Brent Russell, the defensive tackle, kind of blew by him and two-hand touched him down to the ground. Yates couldn't squiggle out of that one. And North Carolina calls a quick timeout here with just under 90 seconds to go in the half. After a loss, they'll have a second down and 15 coming up. So just a quick break for North Carolina. They just want to settle themselves down a second and see if they can figure out a way to score one more time before they get to the half and start working on something that they haven't had a chance to work on in a while, their depth. The offense has so few guys that are healthy. They need to work in some second team guys, because you know when you get in those tight battles, you got to have some guys that are ready to step in when they need to. Here's North Carolina, 21 unanswered points. They scored a couple of touchdowns quickly, and then Georgia Southern got the Urbano run. But three turnovers have resulted in three touchdowns for the Tar Heels here in the second quarter. Quick pass out to the right side. This is Drone. He's off to the races, down past the 30. Inside the 30 to the 27-yard line. A huge play, 34 yards, 24 yards, excuse me.
Yates just looks to the left, linebacker flow to the left, and then swings it out the Drone, and then look at this move right here. Just freezes the defensive back, finds a hole on the outside, and gets first down. And, you know, when you look at this team, if they can just figure out this offensive line situation, they have the playmakers to be successful in the ACC this year.
We saw Jeremy Boyd down there blocking for it. That's, you got to have that if you're going to have a play go for a lot of yards. And there's Boyd making the catch there, getting rewarded for his downfield blocking. A three-yard reception and another timeout. North Carolina calls that timeout. Don't forget, we've got some more ACC action coming up here on ESPN 360. Tonight, starting at 6:30, Maryland takes on Wake Forest. You're just one click away from that ball game, and then at 7 o'clock, Florida A&M travels down to Miami to take on the Hurricanes. Two games tonight here on exclusively on ESPN360.com.
And how about Maryland getting back on the winning track? I mean, shocking Clemson after they struggled really all year. Their offense turned the ball over so much, and you know, defense really couldn't stop too many people. And then they really turned things around against Clemson last week, and very interested to see how they take that momentum against Wake Forest.
Wake has an offense that's dynamic as well, but had trouble stopping Boston College a couple weeks ago. So that'll be an interesting ball game tonight at 6:30 here at ESPN 360. Drone bounces off a guy, spins, wrangles forward to the 15-yard line. The clock will stop for the chains to move on a gain of 10 yards. By the way, T.J. Yates, 11 pass completions. Eight different gentlemen in blue have caught a pass from him as Presme made this stop. And that's spreading the ball around. Let's see if what he does here. A little quick out. Out of the backfield, Drone again. He'll be ridden out of bounds at the 11. Four-yard gain, and the clock will stop there with 42 ticks remaining, with Benefield running him out of bounds.
And Yates has done a really good job, you know, managing this football game on short throws. The one area of criticism that I've seen, or, you know, not maybe not criticism, but something he can really improve on, is throwing the football downfield. He's had a couple opportunities where his receivers, and he's got fast guys on the outside that can stretch this field. He just, they need to get on the same page with those big plays, because in a lot of games, maybe not necessarily this one, those are the plays you have to hit. Those are the big play, you know, plays that against a really good opponent that you don't want to have back. But if you miss the pass,
well, you'd like to show it on film too, so that the other teams have to respect that play.
Absolutely,
you have to make sure the defense is playing you honest. As Houston runs for five, down to the 6-yard line. They need 1 yard for first down. Houston bounces to the outside, bowls over one guy, and he'll be just shy of the goal line. Give him 5. He needed 6. It's a first down. So the clock will stop. 18 ticks left. Hyden made the stop. A snap, and Yates is trying to lean on that line to get him into the end zone. And now timeout is called. The final one for the Tar Heels. They have 10 seconds and 2 plays if it goes incomplete. If it stays in bounds, probably just the 1 play.
And you look at Coach Davis here. You know, we were on the phone with him this week. Just an amazing person, great recruiter. It's so evident when he talks about his football team how deeply he cares about his players. And he's served under legends, Jimmy Johnson for 15 years at Oklahoma State, went to Miami, coached under Barry Switzer, took over Miami and did very, very well, and then left Miami to the pros, was a head coach at the Cleveland Browns. But he's a master recruiter. I mean, when he's at Miami, he recruited guys like Ray Lewis, Jeremy Shockey, Sean Taylor, Reggie Wayne, and, you know, this guy is a guy that can take this UNC, I believe he's a guy that can take this UNC football team atop the ACC. And if you look at the young talent they have, if they develop through his system and believe in the system and have a few lucky breaks here and there, I think in the next couple of years this could be a team to contend for the ACC championship.
More on that in a little bit. I do want to address that point. Houston. And he's in. His 3rd touchdown of the day from 1 yard out. And the Tar Heels have breached the 40-point mark here at home. What can you say but wow? He had 4 touchdowns coming into today, 3 more today.
We might see 80 points in this game before it's all said and done.
Barth, the extra point up and good, and they may have to go to the shed and get some more fireworks. I think they've shot off everything they have here in the first half. 6 touchdowns, 2 by the defense. 4 on the ground, 3 by that man. Oh, and Sean Drone had one. His first of the year. That's not the guy I'd trade places with today.
His triceps are going to get tired.
Oh, my goodness. I think he said he needed some of your power bar. Now, Houston's not tired. I mean, if touchdown runs have been 7, 4, and 1, it's not like he's worn out. 12 plays, 64 yards. That one for 3. I mean, he's not tired.
I doubt he's tired, but I mean, that's a great scoring drive with, you know, now with 10 seconds left, you know, going into halftime with a 42-7 lead. I mean, you got to feel pretty good about yourself offensively, defensively, and they've been playing very well on special teams as well.
Now they've kicked all 6 of the extra points. They've kicked off a lot, a couple of them into the end zone. Not really sure what more you can work on in a game. You got to get some backups, and they'll do the old chip shot kick here and let it go out of bounds for the penalty. And since no one touched it, no time came off the clock. So Georgia Southern can go for broke or take a knee and get the heck out of Dodge.
Kick out of bounds on a kicking team. 5 yards. We will re-kick.
Did he say re-kick?
Georgia Southern said, we'll kick it again. Won himself a national championship as a coach at Valdosta State.
Look at that record, 76-12.
6 playoffs, 1 national championship, 1 runner-up, 1 quarterfinal. He is 91-23 as a head coach overall in his career.
And when he came to Georgia Southern, he in 2007, he led the Eagles the 2nd biggest turnaround in school history.
Yep.
They won four more games than they had in a previous year, 2006.
And considering it's Georgia Southern, that's not easy to do. I mean, they don't see a lot of lean years there. They're coming out of the same right now, and he is the right man for that job. I firmly believe that, talking to him this week. He gets it as a coach. He's a real personable guy. I can see why his guys love to play for him. And we just said the same thing about Butch Davis. I mean, that guy's a professional speaker. He was on the NFL Network for a while. As an analyst, I really enjoyed his insights. And I can just see, boy, that'd be – if I had Coach Hatcher and I had Butch Davis in my house selling their programs to me, I'd have a hard choice because these two guys really get it.
I couldn't agree more. They'd have you in the house, but then you'd take a look at the facilities and go to the stadiums.
I wasn't going to go there.
And, then you'd probably make a decision, to go to the ACC and with a team that could you went out in the ACC, you're going to the national championship game, and as a player, that's something that you look at when you're recruited by a lot of different teams.
Butch Davis is a master storyteller too. Well, he had us going when we talked to him earlier this week. Urbano, whoa. He was met rudely by Marvin Austin at the line of scrimmage and deposited, and Georgia Southern is going to be glad just to sit down and get some orange slices and regroup as we head to the second half. 42-7, three touchdowns for Ryan Houston, two touchdowns by the defense. And Yates leading them to a 42-7 first half lead. At the half. Here from Chapel Hill, we're enjoying ourselves here. Hope you are wherever you are watching college football here on ESPN360.com. Let's take a look at what we saw in the first half. Jeremy, we saw a whole lot of North Carolina on the ground, offensively and defensively.
Oh, Houston just put on a clinic on how to be a successful short yardage running back, and then Drone right here shows his ability to find the end zone for the first time of the year, so Houston couldn't come in there. And then a great strip right there. Their defense put on an absolute clinic on how to dominate an opponent and score some points. A great strip there. And then Houston again, just showing great body control, strength, vision to get in the end zone for six.
And then Bruce Carter, it wasn't all offense. Bruce Carter intercepted it and ran it back. The defense forced four turnovers in the first half. Houston, three touchdowns, ties a career high for him. He only had four touchdowns on the season coming into the game, and he's got three today. It's been a whole lot of the Adam Urbano show.
Yeah, 91 yards rushing in the first half. They only have 94 total rushing yards, so he has been their offense, and he played very well, but he did give up that costly fumble to Struvent that led to a touchdown. But he's impressed me with his vision and his ability to break tackles and his breakaway speed. But as you'll see, 94 yards rushing and only 32 yards passing.
The UNC defense has 102 yards, 61 on fumble returns, 41 on the interception return. That is the hidden yardage that you don't see in a lot of stat sheets, as you saw the first half. And boy, what do you do if you're Chris Hatcher? What do you talk about at halftime? Do you just say, look, guys, we just got to press the reset button, start over, and see if we can establish some kind of offense here this week?
Well, it's tough because, when your coach says, hey, it's 0-0, yeah, everyone says that, but as a player, you know it's not 0-0. But what he does have going for him is we talked about that big comeback that he led, the largest in NCAA history against Western Carolina, down 28 points with 11 minutes left. And so his kids can believe that maybe they can do it here in the second half.
But you can't get it all back on one play, but you can get it back a touchdown at a time as the Carolina Tar Heels return the kick. Calvin West made the stop. It was Greg Little on the return. Here are the last six possessions for North Carolina. They did have to punt twice, but they drove it down 89 yards for the touchdown to start the half. The defense scored two touchdowns. And offensively, four out of six scoring touchdowns. Of course, that one, a 16-yard run play by Drone to start a possession after the turnover. And they'll go to the right side in Houston. He'll run around the right end and get close to a first down. He'll have a first down. 12 yards on the carry to continue his day. He had 12 carries and 42 yards in the first half and three touchdowns.
And he usually doesn't get carries with this much green grass in front of him. Usually he comes in the red zone, and I'm sure he's pretty excited about this opportunity.
His long carry of the season, just 20 yards. And now Yates will throw. Going down for the big bomb, but his receiver didn't quite make the turn in time. That was 83 Dwight Jones with LaRon Scott hanging around in the vicinity.
And you see there again, I mean, Dwight Jones, you know, had a step on the defensive back. And one thing that North Carolina and T.J. Yates can improve on is his deep balls, because he does have playmakers on the outside, fast playmakers that can get down the field.
They'll give it to Houston again. Spins off of one guy, wrapped up by the second man to him. Tackle by number 90, Markeith Wiley. As Houston will scamper forward for not much. Here's the most points allowed in the first half in school history. But some of those are by the defense, and most of the time they're not facing one of the top defenses in the FBS. They've given the North Carolina offense short fields. They've scored twice on their own. They've taken the ball away four times. Yates with time and space, and he's going deep, and he overthrows Greg Little. They've tried the deep ball a few times. They just can't seem to get together. It's not from a lack of trying.
Little got up a little shaky. Really dove for that ball, landed awkward on his shoulder, but you can see Yates roll out, and he had two guys, and he picked Little on the sideline here, and Little went after it. You got to give him credit for diving, but just too far and out of bounds.
So for only the third time today, North Carolina's got a punt. Wiggins driven back to his 18. And a quick tackle, grabbed him by the jersey, and maybe a negative yard after the 46-yard punt. Great hang time, no return. And that is where the Eagles will start first down and 10. So the other 23 and 21, Denoris Searcy, as well as Jordan Hemby, made the stop. Now we'll see if there are any tricks up the sleeve of this offense. 10 out of 16 for just 32 yards, so 2 yards an attempt and two interceptions for Chapel. Quick throw. The receiver was down when he caught the ball, so this will be a negative catch. Minus 3 yards on the reception, and here's what happened to the five possessions of Georgia Southern. Fumble. Two picks, a punt, and then the half end.
Not the way you want to start a game. Fumble, two interceptions.
And a negative play on their first play of the second half. And now they'll run it with Zeke Rozier, number 26. Cam Thomas, number 93, that man was there in the backfield to stop it quickly. Maybe made up one of the lost yards. Third down and 11. Pin your ears back and come time for the defense of North Carolina. Not that they haven't done that all day today. Three receivers right. One man isolated to the left. Play clock running down. Chapel's got to get it off. He does so, but it will not be for a first down. The catch made out there. Pass to Valentine. Kendrick Burney in the area. It'll be fourth and three or so. And Georgia Southern will have to punt it again. And that was where the deal where Chapel kind of got in a little trouble and his receiver couldn't, had to come back to him a little bit.
Then it was Robert Quinn providing the pressure and actually a really good catch by Jamari Valentine to tiptoe on the sidelines, but just not enough for the first down.
See if they try that rugby-style running punt. Nope. Trying for the tall, deep one. Fair catch called for at the 37-yard line, and that's where the Tar Heels will take over after a 36-yard punt. Yates and the offense back out with a 5-touchdown lead.
I really love how fast this PC with Windows 7 wakes up. You just open it up, and oh, there it is. Sweet. Oh. I'm a PC, and I'm out of here.
42-7, all Tar Heels. From inside Keenan Stadium, that will undersee some additions in the coming years. They just announced the new Keenan additions that they'll have coming up. And this is a good week to really talk about or for the fans to know that new additions are coming, and they want to see some progress on the field, and that's what they're getting today. New quarterback in there for North Carolina. Much of the same that they've seen, though, as Houston carries on first down.
Well, carry number 32, Ryan, in Houston for the Tar Heels.
And we're going to start to see a lot of young kids get some experience and playing time today. It's something that Coach Davis and offensive coordinator John Shoup talked about before they knew it was going to be a 42-7 game, that's their mentality. They really like doing that. They'd rather not redshirt guys. They'd rather get them into a rotation, get them that game experience. It's so valuable in the progression of these young college football players.
A.J. Blue in there running the offense. The football is out. And it's still out, and Georgia Southern's going to come up with it. Looks like, well, now it came out again. Three or four different guys got their hands on the football. I thought Brent Russell was going to end up with it. And a flag flies out as somebody got stepped on over there. And Georgia Southern does have it as guys are peeling each other off the pile.
You're going to take a look. Anytime you bring in inexperienced players, these are some of the mistakes that can happen. And just looks like he just lost the football. Wasn't a great angle to see if it was stripped or if it just kind of slipped out of Blue's hands. But, you know, rolls out to the right and the football pops out.
It looked like Little got spiked on his hand. He's coming off the field with the trainers. And I thought I saw he was mad that he got stepped on. And let's see if the penalty is on that occurrence.
There's a fumble in the play, recovered by Georgia Southern. After the play, dead ball, personal foul, unnecessary roughness. Number 8, North Carolina. That's half the distance to the goal, first down.
That's exactly what happened. He got stepped on and didn't like it, shoved a guy down there, and that's what the flag was for.
And coaches will always tell you, it's not the guy who initiates it.
It's not the first guy.
It's the second guy that always gets the penalty. You're going to see Little come in here from the left. There he is right there, jumps and tries to get involved in the play. And something happened down there that, you know, he didn't like. And, you know, then he's going to retaliate and eventually get the flag. But coaches talk about that all the time. I mean, you can't be the guy that retaliates because the first guy very rarely gets those penalties.
Urbano to the left side will be shoved out of bounds at the 10 after a 4-yard pickup. A nice job by him getting over there. It was Zach Brown forcing him out. Deontay Williams.
Another penalty.
Made the stop as the flag flies in late.
Coach Hatcher telling his guys to calm down.
after the play, dead ball, personal foul, unnecessary roughness, number 9 of the defense. That penalty is half the distance of the goal. Automatic first down will be first and goal.
And we talked about how North Carolina was the least penalized team in the conference coming in. Just 36 yards a game. And now they're going to be way over that today with a couple of 15-yard penalties. First down and goal. Urbano is wrapped up quickly and snowed under. A nice job defensively by Zach Brown, the outside linebacker, coming in to make the stop.
Yeah, great job by Zach Brown, the Will linebacker, coming off the edge and tackling. But here's the largest deficit overcome, 28 points like we talked about against West Carolina.
And that was at the start of the fourth quarter. They were down by that much. They did it in less than a quarter, forced overtime, and won it at Western Carolina, which is about 2 hours or so, 2.5 hours west of here. The ball came out as they tried to force it out of Urbano's hand, but his forward progress was well stopped. And sometimes it can be fun as a defense to let the first man hold you up and let all your buddies get in there and try to strip and rip.
And that's exactly what happened here. You're going to see Strudemont come in first. And again, he's great at stripping the football. We saw it in the first half when he took it back for 6 points. And he does it again there. And, you know, I'm not really quite sure if he was down, if that forward progress had ended. That looks pretty close to me. And obviously, Coach Davis thinks that was a fumble. And Strudemont's doing the chicken dance. I'm not sure what that means.
Looks like we have a timeout on the field, and we will step aside. A little bit more than 9 minutes left in the third quarter. Georgia Southern trying to breach the goal line for the second time tonight. 42-7, Georgia Southern. Third down and goal. They need the goal line to convert the third down. They've only converted 2 out of 9 today. Shotgun. The pass is short. Short hopped his man over there, Patrick Barker, with Charles Brown in the area. And it looks like the Eagles will settle for a triple. 24-yard, 25-yard chip shot for Adrian Mora. 8 out of 10 so far, and he booted 2 in their big road win at Wofford last week. His field goals were 48 and 50 yards. This one much simpler for him, a 25-yarder, and it's through, and the Eagles have their second score of the day, 42-10, with 9 minutes and a tick left in the third.
And more, you know, you mentioned the 2 kicks last week, and first game against the season against Albany, he kicked a 44-yarder to win the football game. He's a very good place kicker.
We've got more football coming up here this evening on ESPN 360. We're at the midway point of the season, and these games, especially that first one there, mean a lot to Maryland and Wake Forest. That one kicks off at 6:30, just under an hour from now. And then down in Miami, the number 11 Hurricanes hosting Florida A&M. Ja'Cory Harris, I think he's got an outside shot at a Heisman, maybe. He's had a dynamic year. They've beaten a bunch of ranked teams to start their year, and not going to say they've got a week off, but certainly an opponent that is not of the caliber they've been used to facing. 5 plays, 18 yards, a little less than 2 minutes as the Eagles get on the board in the second half with the Mora 25-yard field goal, thanks in part to the fact the defense picked up that loose ball that was dropped by the backup quarterback for North Carolina. So a short field, and Georgia Southern able to capitalize. The lights are on here at Keenan Stadium as we get ready for North Carolina's next possession. A dangerous leap by the returner, Little, who's back out there after coming off the field after that last scrum. He'll return it 18 yards on the kickoff return, and that's where the Tar Heels will start first and 10 at the 26-yard line. John Stevenson to stop for Georgia Southern. Lots to cheer about for those in the Carolina blue as Yates back out there at quarterback. So the brief blue experiment over for the time being. Drone decided to go through a different hole, but Georgia Southern had something to say about that. Deion Dubose, the middle linebacker, comes through and makes the stop for a negative gain.
Had a great job by Dubose getting in there and blowing up the play. And Drone actually made a pretty good move when he got the handoff, tried to get away, but he is their leader. He plays the mic position very well for Georgia Southern.
Second and 12 after the two-yard loss. Yates, a quick drop and a step and a throw and a catch. Jeremy Boyd made the catch on the quick slant. LaRon Scott on the stop.
And those slants and pirate routes as a receiver, you're going to see Jeremy Boyd, a true freshman here. Those are the hardest catches to catch, especially with T.J. Yates throwing the ball as hard as he can. When you're coming back to the quarterback, when you're attacking the football, those are very hard catches to make, and a good job by Jeremy. He dropped that ball in the first quarter, but made a good catch there.
Third down short, a yard and a few inches. But North Carolina will convert for the first down over the right side. Over to the 40-yard line as Drone makes another carry for positive yards and converts for a first down. That's his 10th carry of the game tonight. Over to the 40-yard line, and he'll have almost 70 yards rushing. Clock still rolling. First down and 10 for the Tar Heels. Up big at home the week before the bye. A little trickery, but Drone has it. And he'll gain about 5 to the 45-yard line.
And one thing the UNC offense has done a great job at so far today is controlling the game clock, running the football. You see Drone's number 11 rushes, 74 yards and a touchdown. And, you know, that's something that they could not do against Virginia last week. They could not manage the game clock. They couldn't get a first down. And, you know, they came out today and have done a much better job at managing the game clock and moving the football.
Virginia has some life. They're up big against Indiana today, so trying to prove that last week's game was not a fluke. As Drone again carries for about 4 yards, he'll be about the length of the football shy of the first down, which is midfield. This ACC has been very interesting the last couple of years with a whole bunch of teams tied up at around 500. It's hard to, with so many dynamic offenses and defenses in this league, to really establish yourself and consistently win on a weekly basis, because every team is so very different in the way they play football. Here's Yates to keep it to fall across for the first down and into Georgia Southern territory. Spotted down at the 48. A lot of young quarterbacks in this league, so you're getting some inconsistent play. Harris is a sophomore. Skinner is one of the few that's a senior. Young guys at Clemson. Here Yates is a junior. I still think of him as a young guy, although he's been a starter for a while. And if it's not the quarterback that's the young guy, it's the guys you're throwing to that are young, which also causes those continuity problems. Quick out to Little. Makes two guys miss and slips up to the 45-yard line. It's hard to get a bunch of different people from different places and get them all on one page. I don't care how well spring practice goes. Game day is a little different. It's hard to get everybody on the same page. There's Little's yardage totals. You can see in 09, he's pretty much equaled what he's done the previous 2 years combined. Receptions and yardage. Clearly one of the guys to look at in the ACC. End around play. Or Drone out of the backfield. He'll get maybe a yard to the 44-yard line, ridden out of bounds by Darryl Pascoe, the cornerback for North Carolina.
And, you know, Ryan, you mentioned it. I mean, when you have young players coming in, getting into a rhythm is so important, no matter how talented you are. And when you have injuries like they have, and it's so many, eight guys on the offensive line going down, it's not that these guys aren't as talented. It's just getting into that rhythm, getting used to game speed takes a little time.
Flags. Somebody moved early in the blue. It's going to be on the center. Eight penalties for North Carolina tonight. A little uncharacteristic for them. 57 yards in penalties coming in. We talked about it, averaging just over 35. Young center with a snap infraction there. Everything flows right for Yates. He loads up and lets her fly. Almost picked off, but it goes out of bounds. Derek Hayden back there in coverage number four. Giving a diving attempt. And North Carolina, thanks to that penalty, will have to punt it away. This was kind of the problem they saw last week. They'd get 5, 6 yards, 7 yards, and then they would move back 5 or 10 yards, and that's why they had to punt so much. They hurt themselves as much as Virginia did last week. And even though they've had a few more penalties this week, they've been able to move the chains and be efficient. A high kick that just trickles into the end zone from Grant Shalek. So the Eagles will get the ball back at the 20-yard line. A 49-yard punt goes for a touchback. 42-10, North Carolina. They've not scored here in the second half, but the band is pretty much the only unit that did not score for the Tar Heels in the first half. Everybody else did. The defense did. The offense did. No passing touchdowns in this game, by the way, interestingly enough. Everything's been on the ground. Speaking of on the ground, there's that man again, Urbano, trying to get himself over the 100-yard rushing mark today. Won't get it on that carry, but he'll be close. 93, 94 yards today on the ground for that man.
Yeah, and really only made one mistake with the fumble. But Strudevant just stole his lunch money.
He's not nice. Now to the left side. And nothing. A whole lot of nothing for Darian Robinson as Smith snuffed it out. Jonathan Smith, number 28.
That's another recorded tackle for a loss for North Carolina defense that is so good, averaging almost 10 tackles per game for a loss, which that is a tremendous number.
It's ridiculous. GSU 2 out of 10 on third down, and that's going to make it tougher. Needed 7, now they'll need 12. Cole Fountain, the right tackle.
Now, we haven't talked too much about Cole Fountain today, but he's the senior, he's the leader up front, he's the captain, and just got a little too excited. And I would be too if I was trying to guard E.J. Wilson.
I was going to say, he knows what's facing him over there. They'd have to take me out. I'd be jumping so early every time. Those guys are huge. Go for it here. Over the middle. Incomplete. Nice job over there by Jonathan Smith in coverage. Trying to hit Garyon Taylor, number 83. Here's Mr. Smith.
And you're going to see Chapel here throw really good football. I mean, a catchable football in traffic. You got to come down with that, Taylor.
So after the penalty, we'll have a punt back from his own 7 towards the sideline. It will get out of bounds right around the 46 or so. Make it the 48. So officially a 24-yard punt. maybe a little more than that, 34 yards. How about that?
It's been a fast third quarter. You know, it's gone by pretty fast, but it's been a sloppy one, too. Some penalties for UNC, some uncharacteristic, you know, personal fouls. And that's what happens sometimes when you have a lead. You kind of relax and you forget about the discipline. And you just kind of play backyard football.
New quarterback in for the Tar Heels. Braden Hansen, who is 0 for 2 this season, throwing the football with an interception. And they'll just let him hand off on his first play to Drone. 5-yard carry for Drone, and he's getting up to close to 100 yards. He has 85 yards rushing. Braden Hansen, the freshman out of Charlotte. Darius Eubanks on the stop for the Eagles. Hansen played at Charlotte Latin, a private school down in South Charlotte. Off of Providence Road, been there a few times myself. A lot of in-state guys on this roster as a 1-yard carry on second down. And that's important for a coaching staff, especially one of a bunch of pro guys who aren't from around here, to get in and establish those in-state roads to pick off the best talent that you can pick off here in state. Keep the best ones home and then go try to steal the best ones from everybody else's states. Third down for North Carolina, 50% on the day in that department. And Hansen may get his first toss today. The lefty. Quick pass caught, flags fly. It will not be enough for a first down. As the catch was to Dwight Jones, number 83. He had LaRon Scott hanging all over him. And there are people watching this on their computer saying, what are you talking about? This third quarter went by. We've had 50,000 flags in it.
We have had a lot of flags. There's no question about that.
So two penalties, both on Georgia Southern, a pass interference and a roughing. So no matter what the line to gain was, this will be a first down.
There are two fouls on the play. Pass interference, number 34 of the defense, is declined. Personal foul, roughing the passer, number 33 of the defense is accepted. There's a completed pass. It will be 15 yards from the end of the run. Automatic first down.
So Scott was hanging all over the receiver, and he still caught the ball anyway. DuBose gets the roughing penalty, and here's Georgia Southern penalties. They are the most penalized team in the SoCon. Just 3 penalties today for those 25 yards. Most penalized because they play so fast. A lot of those penalties are from just playing quickly. And they'll get Hansen down in the backfield. Nice job back there running through the line. Number 40, J.B. Shippey, a backup strong side linebacker, backing up Williams. We've talked about him a few times. Sophomore out of Gaffney, South Carolina. It's the fourth time they've gotten back there into the backfield and taken down the quarterback for North Carolina. And we have an injury on the field. Here's an 11-yard loss.
I'm going to take a look at the sack here. Shippey, another guy that was on the freshman all-SoCon team and just does a good job of not letting Hansen get out of the pocket. And a nice little sack for the young man.
Well, this is more bad news for North Carolina. That's their center, Cam Holland. How many more offensive linemen can go down for them this year? This is a year where the training staff might get a varsity letter.
That's number 9.
Number of guys they have to rehab and, oh. I mean, when the backups are starting and then the backups are getting hurt, and they give you each week, the media staff will give you what's called a 2-deep, which is basically the starters and their backups. And on the offensive line, a lot of the starters back up other positions because they're so thin. So there's Tavares Brown. That guy was a defensive lineman. They had to move him to the offensive line. Played at Richmond Senior High School down in Rockingham. He was an outstanding defensive end in high school. Now he's got to come in and play offensive line for the Tar Heels. That's the end of the third quarter. We'll flip it over to the other side and come back 42-10. North Carolina on top. We've seen a lot of woo plays today on offense and defense, and you got a quick taste of them there. 42-10 here from Chapel Hill. Ryan Rose, Jeremy Bloom, thanks for clicking on over and catching this exclusive presentation on ESPN 360 as an interception. As soon as we come back from break, what did I just say? LaRon Scott. We just had some woo plays today, Jeremy, and LaRon Scott steps in front of the passing lanes for the first interception by a Carolina quarterback today as we take a look at the stats through three quarters of play. And a big turnaround right there as Southern will start on the turnover.
You know, you put these young kids in for UNC and Blue comes in on the first drive and fumbles the football, and then, you know, Hansen comes in and throws an interception. But really, credit to LaRon Scott, 34, for Georgia Southern. That was great coverage, you know, on a simple in route, and he was all over it.
Coaches will tell you, if you just put yourself in the right position, sometimes plays just happen for you. Chapel, they want to get some back in a quick hurry. He'll hit his man up to the right side, Patrick Barker, for a 9-yard catch. Charles Brown came over and shoved him out of bounds, but a nice pickup on first down. Open up the playbook a little bit. I know both coaches said that offensively they kind of scaled back the playbooks in practice, make things a little bit simpler for their young quarterbacks. And so far it has worked for North Carolina today, and you can see Georgia Southern trying to maybe this time de-simplify, throw a few more plays in there because this defense has been so good and is anticipated so well. 7-yard play for a first down, a 6-yard play for a first down. Robert Quinn made the stop, but Darian Robinson made it a first down and a conversion for Georgia Southern. Just short of midfield. Fake it to Robinson, now throw it. Did he catch that? I know he juggled it and it hit the ground. It will say no catch for Jameer Valentine with Brown knocking him down. Let's see what happened.
The ball was just a little late. Valentine was open, and Chapel just left a little bit too much time on that ball. And good concentration, but looks like it might have just hit the turf.
Yeah, off his face mask, and had hands on the side of it, but once it touches that ground, they're not going to give you credit. Here's Robinson. Not a whole lot, if any. He was met at the line by Alaric Mullins. Ulrich Mullins, the senior from Caruthersville, Missouri.
And you get a look there at D. Robinson, 5'9", 172 pounds, running back, freshman, coming into the game, 213 yards on the ground, averaging 4.8 yards a carry, and one touchdown.
Eagles have not converted a third down in this half. Just two in the game. Going for it here. Oh, what a nice rip out of the air, and a first down catch is made. That's Barker. Boy, he just ripped that ball out of the air. He and Williams collided. Searcy came in late. An 18-yard completion and a third down conversion for the Eagles.
You're not going to see it on this replay, but Barker makes a great second-level release. He's about 10 yards, 15 yards up the field. You're right there, and he just swim moves and create separation. And as a receiver, it's, you know, you got to create separation off the line of scrimmage, but a second level release is very important, and Barker did a great job at separating himself from Williams
and Searcy collided as Barker went down quickly. Those two guys hit each other, and that's Williams coming off. Barker no worse for the wear. He leads the Eagles with five catches today. 35 yards also leads the team, so a pretty good day for him. Some of these young wideouts continuing to try to establish themselves. A pass right past the umpire as he dove out of the way, incomplete. Looking for Jameer Valentine, one of the other young guys they're trying to get going here with Jonathan Smith in coverage.
The umpire took a dive.
Yeah, he did.
Looked pretty athletic. And George Southern that time just ran a lot of crossing routes, and that's something that Everett Withers saw on tape that they like to do. They run a lot of different crossing routes, but this UNC defense has not given them an inch.
Second down, 10, trying to run to the left side. Nothing doing there either. Aaron Robinson not finding the kind of success that Urbano found in the first half. He may have gotten credit for a yard. And this is Southern Conference football. Small, scat-back type rushers. You're hard to find, hard to locate. Not working so well today against the Tar Heels. Zach Brown came up and made the stop. Once they've located him, they hone in on him. He's got a couple hundred yards rushing this season coming into today. Today, just 5 yards on four carries. Long third down here for the Eagles. A pump and go. His man is wide open, and he just overthrows him. Oh, my goodness. Urbano on the pump and go. You've been saying they've needed to do that for a little while. Jeremy's been trying to get him to do that. Searcy, well, we'll say Searcy was the closest man.
And this is hard to do. I mean, you look at UNC's defense. This is a base cover two, and pump and goes. How do you get that open? I mean, you have two safeties back and in center field, and your corner's off the line of scrimmage. And he had Chapel had Urbano wide open for an easy touchdown.
I think he was surprised he was that open.
I do, too.
You got to have time for a play like that, though, and that's what he hasn't had today. The offensive line did a great job of giving Chapel some time. Fourth and nine. Had a little time there, going for the end zone. Nobody's there except the defender. And it's another turnover, an interception by Kendrick Burney. That is his first pick of the season. And with two picks by linebackers, that's three interceptions today. Nearly doubling the total of four that they had coming into the ball game. 42-10. A second left in the fourth. Carolina with a big lead. Kendrick Burney picked off Lee Chapel in the end zone. His third interception today. Two by the linebackers. And one by a corner as Carolina comes out on a first down for 11 yards as A.J. Blueback in there for the Tar Heels. He was running a little wildcat earlier. It's Braden Hansen, the quarterback for North Carolina. Josh Rowe, backup linebacker, made the stop, but not before the Tar Heels could get a first down. Hansen loses the ball again. Center quarterback exchange. It's going the other way. Backup quarterbacks have three giveaways here.
Yeah, that's two fumbles by young quarterbacks, and we also had an interception. And, you know, these are the little mistakes. And, you know, it's one thing. It depends on your mentality as a coach. You know, you want to get these young guys playing time, but this is not what you want to happen because this hurts them in their progression. They go home after this game and they feel badly about what they did instead of, you know, building them up. And, you know, young guys are always going to make mistakes, and, you know, the good ones are the ones that mentally can survive from those and, you know, go back and work harder in practice and get better. But, you know, I don't think this is exactly what Coach Davis wanted in, you know, putting his young guys out there. You know, he wants to get them valuable experience. Right now they're having a lot of difficulty holding on to the football.
Hanson's 2 out of 5 on the year, 2 picks and now a fumble. Chapel's going to pump and go up the sideline. Almost caught. Might not have gone for an inbounds catch anyway. Trying to hit his man up the right sideline. That's 84 Patrick Barker. And let's take a look at some more Game's coming up tonight. Just a few minutes, they'll kick it off from Winston-Salem, North Carolina, as Maryland visits Wake Forest in an ACC conference game. And at 7 o'clock tonight, Florida A&M travels to Miami. Another game involving an ACC team. And another tackle for loss by number 90, Quentin Copels. Copels, he'll have 4.5 tackles for loss after this game. And another TFL for North Carolina. How many of those do they have today? My goodness.
And Darren Robinson, you know, that's something that, you know, he's a freshman. He could do that in high school. He'd probably have a lot of success at reversing field, fast guy, but not against this defense.
No. Rolling left, swarmed under, and down goes Chapel. Dante Page Moss, as they say, he blowed that play up.
He sure did. And, you know, as a quarterback or receiver or anything, when you set your feet and you see somebody like that coming around the edge, you are not very happy. I mean, Chapel's just trying to make something happen, sets his feet, and just swarmed by Page Moss.
I don't say it. That's what they say. They say blowed it up. First career sack for that young man as the punt rolls toward the goal line. And will they down it at the one? Yes, they will. Dante Page Moss, a freshman out of Jacksonville, his first career sack. A 40-yard punt, and the Tar Heels pinned in their own 5. To 10, North Carolina. Both teams have turned the ball over like they have hoofs for hands. That's terrible. That's bad. Start over. Ramesses is the mascot down there. He's just kind of chilling. He's actually down on that end zone. North Carolina starting from their own 1-yard line. Oh, that's going to go for a safety. Georgia Southern closed the daylight in a hurry, and the handoff didn't get out of the end zone. So GSU puts up 2.
I mean, they start on the 1-inch line, and a good job by up front by Georgia Southern to penetrate the backfield and get a safety. I mean, that's a nice positive play for the Seagulls football team.
Blue couldn't get out of the end zone. Here's North Carolina's second half possessions. Jeremy, you ready for this? Punt, fumble, punt, pick, fumble, safety.
Yeah, you know,
it's not
that's
too
why,
good.
No, it's not good, and that's why, you know, safety is a nice play for Markeith Wiley. One of the guys that John Shoup mentioned in our call, you know, talented defensive lineman, but it was evident today that this was a mismatch. I mean, you know, Georgia Southern's a great program. You know, maybe in the next couple of years they're going to do, you know, get back to that dominant form where they won, you know, those 6 championships. But they were pushed around today by a bigger and more physical and dominant UNC offense and defense. And that's what UNC needed to do heading into
a
bye.
They had to. They had to come out and play dominant football today because they had doubts. They doubt themselves. Maybe not outwardly to the media who asks the questions, but you know the last couple of weeks falling on their face against Georgia Tech and then just mysteriously not showing up against Virginia. And it's not effort. It's just one or two things happens early. You've played football long enough to know that things can just snowball on you. And you get a couple of big plays, positive plays, and you get a little confidence, and the other guy loses a little confidence. And this is what happened to them last week against Virginia, this type of game, just the reverse. After the free kick, Georgia Southern looking for some positive yardage, a good return, a 20-yard return. And here's what's on the horizon for the Tar Heels. 2 big games on the mothership. They'll take on Florida State on the 20th. They'll have a bye week next week. They'll take on FSU on the 20th right here, and then they'll head to Virginia Tech on the 29th. That game on ESPN also.
Offside on the kicking team. 5 yards. We will re-kick it.
some Thursday action coming up.
And I think the biggest thing that they have to take out of this game, I mean, they have to take the confidence that they built, but they can't overemphasize this win and the success. I mean, they can't wake up tomorrow and feel like all their problems have been solved.
Right.
And, hey, let's go party. You know, it's a bye weekend. Let's relax and have some fun. They need to wake up and say, we did some good things. We moved the ball as an offense. Our defense played lights out, as they continue to do. But we have a lot of work to do before we get into our ACC schedule, the bulk of it with, you know, Florida State and Virginia Tech and Duke and then Miami. Because this team has the talent. We've seen it. They just need to have that cohesiveness. And you brought up the word doubt. That's the worst word or feeling that you can feel in a locker room. I've been in those locker rooms where it starts to creep in. All of a sudden, your leaders are criticizing other players on your team, and you feel like you might be losing your team members. And
guys are looking around for someone else to make a play, and that's never a good thing.
Yeah, great return there.
Georgia Southern's going to have excellent field position thanks to the, as Brian Gupton and Gene Robinson make the stop on a 44-yard return in, a terrific one.
Yeah,
by Ronnie Wiggins.
Ronnie Wiggins, has some holes. Not a great job on the coverage unit for UNC, but Ronnie Wiggins, he's a very good kickoff return man.
A short field here for Georgia Southern. And another quarterback will get in there to get some work. Daryl DeMasi, number 16. He, as a redshirt freshman, has no numbers. No carries, no passes. Getting some action in here.
But he is from Savannah. He's got that going for him.
Love that town.
Forrest Gump.
Second down and 8. And his pass is picked off. Intercepted, Gene Robinson. And that's the 4th interception today by the Carolina defense.
It looked like a little miscommunication here. I think he expected his receiver to hook up, and really no one was home. And he added a number to his career stat sheet, but not the one that he wanted to.
Yeah. Perhaps, is that his first collegiate pass? That's a rough way to start. Yep. 0-for-1 interception, his first collegiate pass.
But the good news is when you start off like that, you got nowhere to go but up.
Look at you in that silver lining. Carolina used too much time.
Delay of game, offense, 5 yards, first down.
Little mistakes here in the second half. The Tar Heels have not looked sharp with some of their second unit guys out there. That's one thing you can do if you're the coaching staff. You can take it to the film room and say, okay, yes, we did win. Yes, we won in convincing fashion, but don't get too high on our horse here, because as, Jeremy, you just said, they've got a lot of stuff they still need to work on, and they can look at some negative plays and bring the guys back down to earth a little bit.
Yeah, and sometimes, especially with a young team, if you don't have really good senior leadership on your football team, young guys can overlook this win, and get too confident in how well they played, or how many touchdowns that they had, or how well the offense executed. And it takes a more mature football player and coaching staff, and I'm sure they'll do it, to say, listen, we did some good things, let's use what we learned out of this game, but we have a long way to go before we're the football team that we want to become,
with a lot of young guys who should be around here for more than a year or two, because they only have 11 seniors on their squad. A 3-yard carry for Blue. One of the fewest number of seniors in the country, as you saw on the graphic just a second ago. So the things they're building on, they can carry over, because a lot of these guys will be back. They won't have to teach as much scheme and playbook. They can start refining rather than rebuilding. And with Coach Davis in his third year here, this is kind of a swing year as they try to continue to recruit in state and around the country and build something that other players can buy into and bring guys in to a system that looks like it's working. That one a little bit overthrown. And the punt unit will come out as Hansen had problems connecting. Ronnie Wiggins was in coverage, and he'll go back to return the punt. Would you believe the only points here in the second half? Oh, this one wobbly off to the right side. The fair catch, it bounces off Wiggins, but he'll fall down on it at the 30. Would you believe the only points here in this half? A 25-yard field goal and a safety, all by Georgia Southern. 42-12, a 49-yard punt, no return. 42-12, a 30-point margin so far for the Tar Heels. All 42 of those points coming in the first half. They have not scored here in the second half with second and third unit guys out there. First down pass incomplete. And that is the third quarterback out there for the Eagles tonight. Kyle Collins, a junior out of Atlanta, Georgia. He looks like a quarterback. 6'3", about 215. Let's see what he's got. Second down and 10 for him. Little pump, little throw to the outside. Caught. Pickup of about 4 yards.
And I love these points of the game, just from a player's perspective, because you know, these young guys, here's Kyle Collins, he's a junior. You know, how long has he worked, you know, to get on the field and play football? And obviously, I'm sure as a junior, he hoped when he went to Georgia Southern that he'd be starting by now. And, you know, it wasn't in the cards for him at that point. But, you know, to get these guys, that you know, all these guys go through the summer workouts. At there at 6 a.m. And, you know, you put in these 6-7 hour days and you go to class and you sweat on the practice field and, you know, you sell out for your team. And, you know, unfortunately, some guys go all five years of school without getting to play, you know, in a game. And I saw it at Colorado in summer. You know, there's one guy in particular. He was a good leader on our football team because we respected him so much. And so it's great to see some of these younger kids and older kids, for that matter, you know, get into the football game and get some experience.
He redshirted and played in the Samford game last year and saw some action in the Western Carolina game 2 years ago, and this is his first action of this season. Fair catch called for near the 25-yard line. A 41-yard punt, no return, and here's what the Tar Heels have done in the second half. Now, granted, this is a second and third team unit, guys, but...
Wow. Wow.
Just throw away the second half film. Or save it for next spring when some of these guys are a year older and they want to go, okay, it can't be any worse than this. And this is what we can build from, yes.
Yeah, that's ugly. But, you know, we can give some credit to Georgia Southern's defense.
I was going to say that. You got it. Those guys are selling out here in the third and fourth quarter, still fighting. First down carry for the Tar Heels. To the right side, it's Blue. And he'll be close to a first down. He's got it, 11 yards.
That's downhill running right there by number 15.
E.J. Webb and Brent Thomas on the stop for the Eagles. 34-yard line, first down and 10. Still working on some things with Braden Hansen behind center. He'll go out of the shotgun and flags fly.
False start, number 70 of the offense. 5 yards, first down.
And guys with face masks tangled up down there. The umpire helping them separate. Coach Davis, a lot to chew on with this game and the bye week coming up. Trying to get some guys healthy and trying to work out just how much of the playbook they can run with a beaten and battered offensive line. it's hard to get continuity when the same five and six guys aren't up there every week, and the guy beside you is a different guy than was there earlier. Blue makes a nice move to get outside, but he got twisted in a weird way, and he's down holding his leg. He'll get 3 yards, but he's paying a price for it right now.
That was just a heck of a move. Look at that move on Evan Mattingly. I mean, that shows his ability to make people miss and just tackle awkwardly. Oh, right on his left knee.
Oh, that's making me cringe up here.
Just gets twisted around, knee twists out.
I don't know how he didn't snap his ankles on that first move. Oh, my goodness. That kid's got some athleticism. And now they're going to tend to him on the field.
Yeah, they're doing the ACL test right now on him. And, you know, I've been.
I hope it's just a strain. That's all you get kind of twisted up and hyperextension. The guy's okay a little. That's what you're hoping for right now. We'll step aside. Hopefully he gets up on his own 2 feet. 42-12 North Carolina in the fourth. Well, sorry to report that he can't get off the field under his own power. A.J. Blue going to have to be carted off. Hopefully he'll be all right. Another blow to this Tar Heel MASH unit that has suffered an inordinate amount of injuries this year. There's no silver lining to guys going down. You think, well, if we could just spread it out, we got enough depth, but it's hit the offense more so than the defense this year, and it just seems like every time you turn around, there's a different guy in the huddle with you that you've got to go out onto the field with. Coach Davis looking on, obviously concerned for his guys. These are just freak things that happen. And they'll wind up the clock, second down. So another running back in there for North Carolina, the seventh different man to carry the ball today. And that's going to be number 40 for North Carolina, who is Hunter Furr, running back out of Louisville. He's also a North Carolina product, played at Mount Tabor High School. Evan Mattingly made the stop. And ESPN.com said top 100 guy. That's the kind of guy that Butch Davis is going to bring in. A big kid for a freshman. Don't see a whole lot of 200-pound freshmen rolling into college. They're not. A lot of times the bodies aren't mature enough to be that big, but he, so far, can take a pounding. Another 2 yard carry for him on third down. It'll be fourth and about 2 yards to go. Look at the guns on that guy. He's got some meat on him.
Yeah, I mean, for a guy, 1 year removed from high school, and you look at another true freshman, Eric Highsmith, the guy at 6'3", came in 175 pounds. He'll be 210 before he leaves this program, and that's where you look to a lot of your talent and young guys coming up, and that's why I think this North Carolina offense, with all the young talent that they have, if they can groom them properly, get them good confidence, and mix in some good senior leadership, I think they'll be very good and have some playmakers on the outside and at running back. And, it's funny because almost every position on the football field right now, you're seeing backups except the offensive line. I'm not sure there's any more backups.
The backups sort of started the game.
It's the same unit that started the game. And, it's tough in college. You have to get creative with your defensive line and look for talent other places. You can't, Coach Davis can't call up a team and trade someone or sign a free agent like he could at Cleveland. And,
right.
And college teams obviously can't do that. So you have to get creative. And they're bringing over some defensive linemen for their offensive line. But obviously recruiting emphasis, I would say, this year as they're talking to these high school kids now is to bring in some good O-linemen.
Well, they only have so many scholarships. That's the other thing. You've got to find talent within. You've got to look down your roster and reload. That makes it tough. A lot of guys in Carolina jerseys on the sideline without pads on. A two-yard gain for Georgia Southern on first down as they start their drive at their own 9-yard line. Michael McAdoo made the stop. Another running back in there, Lamar Brown, a freshman out of Louisville, Georgia. He's a redshirt freshman, number 31, who made the carry on that last stop. Got himself 2 yards, second and 8 for DeMasi in the offense. That will go for naught again. Michael McAdoo again made the stop. His fifth tackle for loss of the season, and a negative 5 will be slapped up on the yardage total for Georgia Southern.
And then you talk about reloading and depth, and there's no question that, you know, this front four, starting with Wilson, Austin, Thomas, and Quinn, their backups, McAdoo, Millens, Powell, and Copels, there may be a little drop-off, but not a lot. I mean, this defense is deep in talent.
Well, the second unit of the defensive line has 8.5 tackles for loss also, which tells you that
that's
even when they get in there, they're making things happen.
And that's just amazing. Starting to rain a little bit here in Chapel Hill.
Nick Kyles makes the catch off to the right side, and it is starting to sprinkle. 5-yard gain, and it will be fourth down and long. As you get a look at Shane Malarkey, the freshman out of Norcross, Georgia. So Charlie Edwards will punt out of his own end zone. It should be good field position for the Tar Heels as the final minute and change runs off the clock. A bounce, and he'll take it at the 41, and he'll be deposited at the 36. 46-yard punt, a negative 4-yard return for North Carolina's 21 to Norris Searcy. We're getting a report from the medical staff, a sprained knee for Blue. So hopefully that's all it is. That's what we're hoping for. Of course, he'll get checked out. They only have one of the better medical centers in the state of North Carolina right across the street. I mean, if you're going to go down in the ACC, go down over here. Duke Medical Center is pretty good, too. And now the rain is pounding down on the players as we reach the final minute of play. 2-yard gain. And Carolina will probably have to run one more play as the rains fall here in Chapel Hill. Boy, it was a beautiful afternoon that held off just long enough for us to get this game in. Want to say give a huge thanks to the North Carolina staff for taking care of us, as well as the Georgia State folks for giving us some access, and Georgia Southern, staff for giving us some access to their coaches and folks this week. It takes a lot of people to make one of these games happen, and we have a lot of folks on our crew that worked long hours today and all week preparing for this ball game. So hats off to all of you folks out there running cameras, replay machines, audio, all the things that it took to bring you this ball game. And Carolina made it an exciting one. The defense scoring a couple of touchdowns. What does it mean? What do they do now and with a bye week, Jeremy, to get ready for Florida State?
Well, I think Coach Davis is going to go in the locker room, congratulate his players, and say, hey, we did some great things today, but we have a long way to go. We can't get overconfident. We have to come back, take this bye week, and get better.
For Jeremy Bloom, I'm Ryan Rose, saying so long from Chapel Hill, where the final score is 42-12 North Carolina. For an archived copy of this entire game, as well as other games on our family of ESPN networks, log on to ESPN360.com. Thanks for watching, everybody. This has been a presentation of ESPN, the worldwide leader in sports. North Carolina, a big win at home, 42-12. Good night.